guys. Welcome to Split.
Thank you. Happy to be here. So tell us where we are.
You are in the basements of the Diocletian Palace. Actually, they are popularly known as basements, but we know them as substructure of the apartment of Diocletian, which used to be above.
But this is the map of what the palace, I guess you could say, looks like today, sort of, but obviously not the surrounding parts. It's changed very much.
Not even the palace. For the background, you should rather play Barbara Streisand the way we were, because we don't look like it anymore, definitely.
So what has changed from the way the palace originally
Well,
looked
almost
today?
Everything inside, apart from the cathedral.
Yeah, where's the cathedral?
Cathedral, peristyle, Jupiter's temple, vestibule, all the city walls and all the substructure are being preserved, and the rest has been changed.
So it's true that if you are not careful, you can people live around here and you can end up in someone's backyard if you're not careful. It is? Wow, that's awesome.
Now, how many entrances are there into the palace?
They were always four entrances, like the Iron Gate, Silver Gate, Golden Gate, and the Brass Gate.
From
the
waterfront. Okay, so we entered through which one?
Oops, pardon me.
Right
through
here.
This one, yeah.
Because if I understand, the Riva obviously was built. So what we entered Split on, that obviously was not there. As you could see, it goes straight into the water.
No, this is just the artificial embankment.
Right.
That came with the centuries, right.
So tell us where we are right now.
Okay, we are... They should give me like smaller stick. Anyway, we enter here through the brass gate and we enter in the occidental part of the cellars, basements, as you prefer. They were actually the substructure of his apartment, because in all this northern area, this was settled by commoners, by slaves, servants, bureaucracy, soldiers, personal guards. So all this southern part was his apartment. As the terrain is falling steadily down to the sea, he couldn't allow himself to live beneath the level of his submissive people, because he was emperor. Furthermore, he was God. So he needed something to elevate his apartment respectfully to the northern zone. But thanks to this, thanks to order of all these chambers, we can easily reconstruct how his apartment looked like once, because everything matches now from down here below with the things that used to be above. And that's why we came under UNESCO, because thanks to these cellars, this is practically the only palace in the world preserved in this manner, up to nowadays, from the Roman Emperor style, you know, like imperial style we had, and this is like, that's why we are so proud of it.
And how were these cellars used?
They were not even used.
No?
No. They were, like, during the Diocletian time, they were not used. But after what happens in the 7th century, Croats are coming, and we were not that polite. Like all the barbarian tribes, well, we didn't come, you know, with the perfumes and roses and candles. Like we were burning down the cities, and all this authentic population had to escape toward Albania and Kosovo, Illyrians, so known. And the survivors from Salona, which used to be the capital of the region of the province of Dalmatia, actually the fourth largest city in Roman Empire, during the Roman Empire, the survivors escaped here in these basements. They were pretending not to be, because all over the enemy was still around. And then during the 7th century, they started to pop out, demolishing everything, especially showing revenge toward the Christian persecutor, Diocletian. And then from their houses from above, you will notice now the holes in the ceiling, because they made themselves a sewer system, and they were dropping down here the material. And then, but this is actually the irony, you know, because we were 4 centuries under the dominion of Venetian Republic. And thanks to the Pope, we saved the history, because they couldn't have come here inside and take our stone away, as they were doing all over. Yeah. And like, you know, like,
they saved
the history, right?
So how much of the open air or palace is left? Is
it's
anything
like,
above us?
Yeah, like everything within the city walls. All the city walls are being preserved,
okay.
Only that the western one, the occidental one, are not visible, because the street that's following the western walls is leaning on this wall. So they exist, but not visible. Anyway, everything inside, the people were recycling this stone that was here from the Diocletian's apartment. So they were just building the palaces and the houses from the all the various medieval styles. Anyway, apart from the buildings I've shown you before, so the trick is that like everything is authentic and original, but 12th century, 10th century, 14th century, you know, like yeah. It all depends. Yeah.
All right, well let's go and explore the cellars.
Okay.
Probably consider the main square or
inside,
the city walls.
Yes.
Now, from what I understand, the Diocletian used to make his grand entrance through here to greet the people. Yeah?
Yes.
How often would he do this?
He wouldn't greet the people. Actually, he was greeted by the people.
Okay, I guess that's yeah.
He was the center of the world. Okay. Now, the trick is that he, as a god, he needed to be adored, and he would do this with his purple color show.
Uh-huh.
You know, like. He was the only person in the empire who could wear the purple color, and like it wasn't allowed to anybody to touch because decapitation. Okay.
Okay.
The trick is that was most expensive color ever. In order to get only 1 gram of purple, you needed to smash 10,000 sea slugs. So that's why it was, beware what you're wearing around here, you know?
Yeah, I think we're all okay today, yeah?
And then, when he would coming out, you know, all illuminated by the sound of Hollywood spectacle, whatever, his worshippers, by force, they would lay down here, arms spread, face on the ground, you know, like making the Latin cross of the bodies, and then he would be greeted. This is what we call prostration, and then again, Christians, we copied him. Because our priests, they have to do it in front of the shrine as well, you know, like.
They still do.
Now, how would you describe the Diocletian's personality? Or, I mean, I know that there's many stories that come along with him.
Well, I must admit, first of all, regarding his, you know, life success from a slave up to a god, he was pretty moody, but this is because he was Dalmatian and we are all moody. And then he was like a big egomaniac. But then again, I would have done the same, you know, if I did this success, like, and the best I can do is, like, here, present my tongue. So, like, and he was pretty much quiet.
Well, I find it so fascinating every time I come to Split that it's such a historical place, but it's so livable, and the people living inside, it's just a very unique city, one of the most special I think I've ever visited.
That's what we like to think about it as well.
Yeah. Okay, well, let's go explore some more. Remember that in the Mestrovic Gallery we saw a miniature version of this. Can you tell us the purpose of this statue here in Split?
the purpose is for the decoration of,
well, like, all of the statues.
But the meaning is something completely different. Yeah. Like, he is actually the symbol of our, let's say, urge to get independence for years and years and centuries and centuries. He actually, as a bishop, started the fight against the Pope in Vatican because he wanted to serve his mass in Croatian language. Because back he started in 925, so we are talking about 10th century. Mm. However, unfortunately, the official permission for all the nations for the masses to be served in their proper language came out in 1963. So he was anticipating, let's say,
like
1,050 years. Yes, so like. He lost the battle, he lost the title, he lost the bishopry, and unfortunately we've lost his traces. Oops. And then, like, but today, as a symbol of this Croatian will for independence that we lost for also 1,000 years, give and take few, now he's standing here, and the people are, they know the statue, not because of all this that I told you, but he's very useful. You see his toe, the people are rubbing his toe in order to make wish.
Okay. Before they enter through the north gate, correct?
Yeah, these are the golden gate of the palace. So this is the north, and this was actually the principal entrance in the palace, because this road that was going from this gate was going up to the capital, that was Salona. You know, the capital of Illyrians and the capital of province of Dalmatia during the Roman times.
Okay, guys, well, I think it's only natural that you touch the big toe and also make a wish. Oh, yeah. So, okay. Marcio, you're first.
Oh.